Welcome to the new session of Ophthalmology Online. Today we will discuss corneal ulcers. These are the learning objectives of today's lecture. So, what is the definition of ulcer? An ulcer is defined as a breach or discontinuity or disruption of the surface epithelium. It could be in any structure, like there are skin ulcers or there are mouth ulcers or gastric ulcers or duodenal ulcers, etc. Same applies to the cornea. So what is corneal ulcer? A breach or discontinuity or disruption in the corneal epithelial surface is called corneal ulcer. This is corneal ulcer. Corneal ulcers can be classified in different ways. On the basis of etiology, they can be infective or non-infective. On the basis of location, they can be central, they can be paracentral, or they can be peripheral. And on the basis of depth of corneal involvement, they can be superficial, which involve the superficial layers like epithelium, or they can involve the deeper layers like stroma, Descemet's membrane, or the full thickness cornea. Deep ulcers can lead to desmatocele formation or even corneal perforation. Infective keratitis can be because of bacteria, fungi, viruses, or protozoans. 65% of infective keratitis are of bacterial origin. The most common cause of non-infective corneal ulcer is trauma, usually blunt trauma or chemical injuries like acid or alkali burns. Other common causes of non-infective keratitis includes Morin's ulcer, which is an inflammatory peripheral ulcerative keratitis not associated with any systemic autoimmune disease. Then we can have peripheral ulcerative keratitis associated with systemic autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, Wegener's granulomatosis, systemic lupus erythematosus, or polyarthritis nodosa. Ulcers can also be seen as in allergic keratoconjunctivitis that we called VKC or vernal keratoconjunctivitis. Sometimes as a complication of vernal keratoconjunctivitis, we can see ulcers on the cornea that are called shield ulcers. Now the infective corneal ulcer, which is the main topic of today's discussion. Infective corneal ulcer or infective keratitis or microbial keratitis is the same thing. It is defined as the discontinuation of normal corneal epithelial surface associated with necrosis of surrounding corneal tissue secondary to invasion of microbial organisms. As I told you before, mostly they are bacterial in origin, but they can be due to fungi, viruses, or protozoas. Whenever we deal with an infective corneal ulcer, we often come across a term called hypopyon. Hypopyon is defined as a pus in anterior chamber. When the word pus comes, we usually think of something that is infected, but in case of hypopyon, usually it is not true. Although the cornea is infective, the hypopyon is usually inflammatory or sterile in nature. It occurs because of associated inflammation of surrounding ocular tissues, that is iris and ciliary body. So it is due to associated iridocyclitis. Because of iridocyclitis, there is increased permeability of iris vessels. Due to that, there is outpouring of polymorphonuclear leukocytes, which leads to exudate formation in the anterior chamber. So the hypopyon is not due to true invasion by the bacteria until and unless the Descemet's membrane breaks and there is direct access of organisms into the anterior chamber. So whenever corneal ulcer is associated with hypopyon, we label the diagnosis as corneal ulcer with hypopyon. See, this is the corneal ulcer and this is corneal ulcer with hypopyon. This is corneal ulcer with hypopyon. And once the ulcerative process is controlled, the hypopyon is absorbed. So the infective corneal ulcer is considered as ocular emergency because it is a vision threatening condition, which if not diagnosed and treated early, it may lead to partial or complete loss of vision. There are some predisposing conditions which may lead to development of corneal ulcers. They can be local ocular factors or systemic immunocompromised states. One of the most common local predisposing factor in the development of corneal ulcer is the use of contact lenses. Overusing of contact lens, improper cleaning and not removing it during sleep causes irritation and inflammation of the corneal surface, especially in hot weather, which sometimes can lead to bacterial keratitis, especially the Pseudomonas, which can become aggressive, and if not treated, it can lead to loss of vision. Then there are dry eyes, xerophthalmia, we call it ocular xerosis, which is a term used for ocular surface dryness, including both conjunctiva and cornea, typically associated with vitamin A deficiency. Then tracheasis, I hope you all know what is tracheasis. It is the misdirection of eyelashes. Eyelashes turns inside towards the cornea and causes constant irritation and disrupts the corneal epithelium. Then entropion, which is the inward rotation of eyelid margin leading to secondary tracheasis. Infective dacrocystitis is one of the most common predisposing factors, especially in our part of the world. Beside ocular factors, there are some systemic immunocompromised states like diabetes, HIV, and prolonged use of systemic steroids and other immunosuppressives. They all lead to reduced host defense mechanism, and patient becomes more prone of getting infections. So as we discussed before, the most common organisms causing corneal ulcers are bacteria. Most commonly Staph aureus, Pseudomonas, Pneumococcus, Meningococcus, Gonococcus and E. coli. The common fungi which can cause keratitis are the Fusarium, Aspergillus and Candida. In viral etiology, we have herpes simplex type 1 and type 2, and in protozoa we have Acanth amoeba, which is fortunately rare but can cause severe and extremely painful keratitis. Now the pathophysiology of microbial keratitis. There are four stages. Number one is the stage of active infiltration. What happens in stage one? Whenever there is a loss of epithelium of the cornea, the microorganisms adhere to the epithelium and they release toxins and the lytic enzymes. In response of that, there is activation of host immune response and it can cause the polymorphonuclear leukocytes they come to the site of ulcer through peripheral vessels and they release the cytokines and interleukins. Subsequently, there is necrosis of the involved tissue and the amount of necrosis depends upon the virulence of organism and the strength of host defense mechanism. Number two is the stage of active ulceration. It results from the further necrosis and sloughing of the epithelium, Bowman's membrane and the stroma. The walls of the ulcer may become thick due to imbibition of fluid and masses of leukocytes. There is circumcorneal hyperemia and also vascular congestion of iris and the ciliary body. So there is associated iritis or iridocyclitis. We can also call it anterior uveitis. Iris vessels becomes hyperpermeable and exudation occurs in the anterior chamber from the vessels of iris and ciliary body and it may lead to hypopyon formation. And if the ulcer progress further, it can damage the stroma and also cause the Descemet's membrane to protrude outward in order to restrict the corneal perforation. It is called desmatocele. But if the desmatocele, if the ulcer is not treated at this time, it may lead to corneal perforation. Third stage is the stage of regression. It is induced by a natural host defense mechanisms and antimicrobial treatment. Ulcer begins to heal, epithelium starts growing over the edges of the ulcer, and finally is the stage of cicatrization, in which there is formation of scar and corneal opacity. The terminal course of corneal ulcer depends upon the virulence of the infecting organisms and the host defense mechanisms and the treatment received. The ulcer may heal with the formation of corneal opacity with or without vascularization. This is the corneal opacity without any vascularization, and this is the corneal opacity with the formation of these new vessels on the cornea. If the ulcer penetrates deep, it may lead to the necrosis of the stroma and causes the Descemet's membrane to protrude, leading to desmatocele. In this stage, the cornea is threatened to perforate. And here you see there is a protrusion of Descemet's membrane, but the anterior chamber is still formed. If it is not treated or controlled at this stage, the cornea may perforate. And here, this is the true corneal perforation. The anterior chamber is collapsed and the aqueous leaked out of it. Sometimes the infected or the perforated corneal ulcer causes organisms to enter into the eye and may lead to the most devastating condition called infected endophthalmitis, in which the whole eyeball gets infected and patients usually end up with the loss of vision. Patient of corneal ulcer comes to you with complaint of severe pain, feeling of having something in the eye. Patient can't open the eye in the bright light. He is having watering, redness of eyes, swelling of lids, and the blurring of vision, depending upon the location and size of the lesion. When you check the signs, the vision is grossly reduced. There is lid edema, thymosis. Thymosis is a specific term used for the inflammation of conjunctiva. And there is a circumcorneal congestion, that is, the congestion is more marked on the junction of cornea and sclera. This is actually not a very good picture to show the circumcorneal congestion, because the conjunctiva here is very swollen and it is hiding the area around the limbus. On cornea, you see a lesion which is yellowish white with irregular margins. Cornea surrounding the ulcer is hazy due to edema and infiltration by the inflammatory cells, and the active area of ulcer takes the stain, which is called fluorescein stain, in which we use the 2% fluorescein dye to stain the ulcerated area. Anterior chamber shows hypopyon, iris may be muddy colored because of associated iritis, and the intraocular pressure may or may not be raised. Although the exact diagnosis of corneal ulcer is made with laboratory investigations, after scraping of the ulcerated area, we do staining and culture sensitivity. But there are certain clinical features which helps us to differentiate between the different etiological agents. Like, this is the typical bacterial ulcers with ulcer with hypopyon, with all of its signs and symptoms we have already discussed. In case of fungus, there are some differences we specifically looks for. Like, fungal keratitis is mostly associated with trauma with the plant material, and it can also be seen in the contact lens users, especially in hot weather. The color of fungal ulcer is grayish white as compared to the bacterial ulcer, which is yellowish white in color. The margins of fungal ulcer are thick and rolled out, and there are satellite lesions, which are the lesions that are distinct from the main lesion. Here you see this is the main lesion, and there is some area in between which is not involved, and then these are the satellite lesions. They are specifically seen in the fungal keratitis. The lesion is densely suppurated. You can see this lesion looks more thick and more aggressive as compared to this eye. But beside all these, again remember, it is very difficult to differentiate clinically between the bacterial and the fungal ulcers, because every time you don't get the same classical clinical picture. That's why we always do these scrapings to identify the exact etiological agent. The viral ulcer has its characteristic pattern. In initial stages, there are swollen epithelial cells, which we call punctate epithelial keratitis, which progress to this typical dendritic pattern. This is the dendritic pattern. After fluorescein stain, when you see this pattern, it is nothing else but the herpes simplex keratitis. And this is the most common presentation of herpes simplex keratitis. In advanced cases, this dendritic ulcer becomes more bigger, and it is called geographical ulcer. Another important difference between the herpes ulcer and other microbes is that this herpetic ulcer is not very painful. Patient complains of discomfort but do not have the severe pain. And when you check the sensitivity of eye, it is grossly reduced in both cornea and the conjunctiva. Finally, we have acanthamoeba keratitis. This is a rare vision-threatening infection, most frequently seen in contact lens wearers, especially who do swimming while wearing their contact lenses. And these organisms grow in the stagnant waters and the swimming pools. The contact lens actually acts as a sponge. They adhere to the surface of contact lens and give access to organisms to enter into the eye. And 80% of patients with acanthamoeba keratitis have history of contact lenses. The condition starts as a mild irritation, which rapidly progresses to severe painful state, and the pain is usually out of proportion to the clinical signs. If you see signs, there is a stromal infiltrate which collates to form a ring-shaped ulcer. There are pseudodendrites. These are the pseudodendrites. They are seen as a branching dendrites, but not the same as the typical dendrites of herpetic ulcer. There is radial keratoneuritis. This is the inflammation of corneal nerves, and because of that, this condition is severely painful. If the condition is not diagnosed and treated early, it may lead to stromal melting, hypopyon formation, and eventually loss of vision. Management includes history, clinical examination, laboratory investigations, treatment, follow-up, and the visual rehabilitation. General measures of management are, if necessary, admit the patient in hospital and identify the predisposing factors like use of contact lenses, ask if there is any history of trauma, identify ocular surface diseases like dry eyes, xerophthalmia, and identify if there is any immunosuppressive state in the patient like diabetes, HIV, or if he or she is using steroids for a longer period of time. Besides asking for specific symptoms of the ulcer like pain, decreased vision, redness, watering, photophobia, also ask for use of contact lenses, trauma, or either the patient is using topical or systemic steroids, or if there is any immunocompromised condition. Look for the specific signs of ulcer like lid edema, chemosis, circumcorneal congestion, and the signs on the cornea like shape, size, location, and color of the lesion, edges of the lesion, condition of the surrounding cornea, presence or absence of hypopyon. Also look for other predisposing ocular causes like trichiasis, entropion, dacrocystitis, and dry eyes. And the most important, always check the corneal sensitivity in every case of corneal ulcer, irrespective of the cause. As we have discussed before, the diagnosis of corneal ulcer is not complete without lab investigation. So after completing the initial examination in the clinic, take the material for lab diagnosis. The procedure of taking material is that after taking necessary sterilization measures, put some topical anesthetic drop into the eye and then scrape the ulcer from its base and the margins. with a special spatula called Kimura's spatula. If Kimura's spatula is not available, we can use bent tip of 20 gauge hypodermic needle, which is easily available in every setup. And if the patient is using contact lens, always send the contact lens, its casing and the solutions to lab for the culture. The scraping material is used for Gram stain, Jimsa stain, and if we suspect fungus, then we specially make request for potassium hydroxide stain, which is used to identify fungal hyphae. Material is also used for culture and sensitivity. Different culture media can be used, like blood agar, chocolate agar, non-nutrient agar seeded with dead E. coli, and the Sabrod's dextrose agar. Blood and chocolate agar are used in every case to detect majority of bacteria, but the Sabrod's and the non-nutrient agar are used in special cases. Sabrod's dextrose agar is used to culture the fungi, and the non-nutrient agar seeded with dead E. coli is used for acanth amoeba. Viral ulcers are diagnosed with the help of PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. It is specific for identification of different strains of virus. These are some culture media. This is blood agar plate and this is the chocolate agar plate. Now the treatment. There are some general measures like hospital admission, or if the patient is using contact lens, ask him to immediately discontinue them. And then the specific treatment. These antimicrobial agents can be used topically, either in the form of eye drops or ointments, and also through the subconjunctival injections. Systemic treatment is usually not effective in corneal diseases because it is an avascular structure, except when the ulcer has peripheral location or there is associated involvement of sclera. Different treatment regimes can be used to treat the corneal ulcers. Either we can start with a single drug therapy, which must be a broad spectrum agent that covers both gram positive and gram negative organisms. Agents which can be used as a monotherapy most commonly includes fluoroquinolone groups. These are ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin, levofloxacin, gatifloxacin and the moxifloxacin. Nowadays this moxifloxacin is widely used as a monotherapy, which is a fourth generation fluoroquinolone. Also, there is an option of combination therapy, in which separate drugs can be used which are effective against different type of organisms. This includes cephalosporins combined with aminoglycosides, and tetracyclines can also be used in combination with others. Different group of antifungals can be used in the treatment of fungal ulcers. They are polyenes, which includes nystatin, amphotericin B and the natamycin. This natamycin 5% is a broad spectrum antifungal and it is widely used in the treatment of fungal keratitis. These are some antiviral drugs, but commonly used agent in the herpetic ulcer is topical acyclovir ointment. Besides using antimicrobial drugs, we also use cycloplegics, which includes atropine and cyclopentolate. The role of cycloplegics is to reduce the spasm of ciliary body, they relax the ciliary body, and so they reduce the pain of ulcer. They also stabilize the blood aqueous barrier and so prevent the leakage of iris vessels and helps in reducing the formation of hypopyon. Then comes the topical corticosteroids. The role of steroids in the treatment of corneal ulcer is very controversial. They can be used when the infection is sufficiently controlled with antibiotics. They reduce the fibrosis process and so reduce the scarring in the cornea. But steroids are absolutely contraindicated when there is a fungal infection or even suspicious fungal infection in every stage of treatment, because they flare up the infection of this fungal keratitis. In the end, we have follow-up treatment of complications like desmetocele or threatened perforation, and the treatment of endophthalmitis, and finally the visual rehabilitation of the patient. But the details of these are beyond the scope of this lecture, so we finish it here. Thank you very much.